With me here today is Shannon Morfin, who's our marketing and growth director. And so when Megan mentioned the tweet stuff, I never pay attention to Twitter, but Shannon's job is to grow our audience by 10 times, so from about 2,000 to 20,000 of the most important people in healthcare. And the only way you do that is by taking what we think is good content and breaking it up into digestible chunks and delivering it to people on mediums that they prefer. And evidently, there are a lot of millennials in this room. You get up the first thing in the morning and check Instagram and Snapchat and Twitter and LinkedIn and Facebook and God knows what else. But so please, Twitter away. I'm being a little funny. I'm enthusiastic. Well, great. Well, Megan gave you a little bit of my background. And so I thought I'd talk today a little bit about the book, about what's happening in American healthcare, which is profound right now. You're all at the sort of leading edge of that. And then also, because I know a fair amount about Advocate, talk about some of the really powerful things that Advocate is doing. This group is really responsible for sending, or defining and sending messages out to the greater community. And the greater Chicagoland and the country as a whole really needs to understand both what's happening in healthcare and how leading organizations like Advocate are advancing the change. So with that, let me tell you a little bit about the book. And you heard I've got a strange background, unusual background. I'm going to get into that in a second, because why did somebody like me decide to write a book about fixing American healthcare? But before I do that, since you're all in healthcare, I'm going to ask you three questions, just yes or no, and I want to see a show of hands. So the United States spends 18% of its economy on healthcare. The next big country with the next highest percentage is France at 12%. How many in here, just yes or no, raise your hand, how many think we need to spend more than 18% of our economy to provide adequate or even superior healthcare services to everyone in the country? Who thinks we need to spend more than 18%? Anyone? One, two people, three people. You know what, I've asked that question probably in 100 forums, and you are the first three to raise your hands to say that. But anyway, most of you believe that 18% is more than enough. So we spend about 80, 85%, and by the way, it's interesting that you're in the back of the room. So we spend about 80 to 85% of our healthcare expenditure in the country on chronic disease. How many think we're winning the war against chronic disease? Nobody, okay. So given almost all of your answers to those first two questions, how many believe we need to shift resources out of acute and specialty care into primary care, health promotion, behavioral health, and chronic disease management? Everybody. So what did we learn? With the exception of three people in the back, it's not a funding issue. There's enough money in the system. It's a distribution challenge. We're not addressing our most important challenge in healthcare, which is the increasing rates of chronic disease and the disease that are increasing rates of obesity and lifestyle, poor lifestyle choice, and the chronic disease that accompanies it. And that we need fairly major structural reform. So it's not really the what to do, it's the how to do it. And I'm going to spend some time on that. But before that, I thought I'd give you a little bit of insight into the book and writing a book and how does somebody who was an investment banker turn into an author and so on. So I started this, I quit banking about 3 years ago and started my company, Foresight Health. So we're about to have our third anniversary. 90% of new companies fail in the first 3 years, so we're going to have a big party when we hit that 3-year milestone, which it looks like we're going to do. But the biggest part of the company early on was writing the book, and we had a whole team working on it. But the deeper I got into the subject matter, the more I felt I was really writing about Star Wars. honestly, you know, the fact, you know, Disney now owns the Star Wars franchise, so you get a Star Wars movie once a year. But the one in 2015 was The Force Awakens. And I started to think my book is the market Force Awakens. And so if you want to take an analogy already too far, even further, you've got the medical empire on one alongside Darth Vader. And it's big hospitals, big insurance companies, big device manufacturers, big pharmaceutical companies, all have done exceptionally well under the current system. And for the most part, are fighting with everything they got to keep it intact. And then on the other side, you've got society, let's call them the Federation. And what do they want? Better healthcare, more affordable healthcare, more compassionate healthcare, more convenient healthcare. And they're really pretty powerful. It's early days. The heroes of the stories are companies big and small, old and new, companies like Advocate that are really trying to deliver on the promise of better health outcomes at lower prices in more convenient settings. And the two forces meet each other in the marketplace, and it's early days, but at the end of the day, the Federation Society, they've got Luke Skywalker and Yoda and the Force on their side, because at its core, America is a value-driven economy. And healthcare is one area where we spend an enormous amount, far more than any other country, and we don't get as much back for it. So that's where the title of the book comes, Market versus Medicine. And the real question isn't where we're going to end up, because we're going to end up with a system that I think ultimately isn't only as good as that of other countries, actually leapfrogs it. It's just how long that's going to take and the path through which we're going to get there, and I'll go through it. But I did promise to give you a little bit of biography. So Megan mentioned that I went to Colgate University. I was an English literature major. And then I went into the Peace Corps in West Africa, where I was a language arts volunteer and a soccer coach. In fact, my proudest moment was my team won the county championship for the first time in the history of the school, which was a big deal. You know, a town of 10,000 people, we had 4,000 people at the game. And they held a parade afterward and carried me through the streets. So I almost retired at that point. And I met a fellow Peace Corps volunteer, returned Peace Corps volunteer. There aren't enough of us here, but it was a remarkable experience in a lot of ways. First of all, I lived through a revolution. Literally went from civilian government to military government overnight, and got to see what happens when a society just has that kind of dramatic shift. Made me very appreciative for how strong our institutions are in this country. You know, we don't even think about that. We just had peaceful transition of power from Barack Obama to Donald Trump, and can you imagine two more different types of people in the office? Yet it happened. But the great thing about Peace Corps was, you know, I almost lived a 19th century existence. No running water. I used to read by candlelight. I had students that literally walked 5 miles to school each day and worked hard. But it gave me a chance to think, season mature. I read the way that people watch TV and was an incredible correspondent. You know, when mail only comes once a week, and you need to get your letters out by Thursday, you gotta do it. So as a Peace Corps volunteer, and when they say it's the toughest job you'll ever love, in many respects it is, because even the easy things are hard when the entire culture is completely alien to us as individuals. When I actually became an investment banker, which my own 25-year-old self would have been more surprised at than almost anything else. I didn't even know what discounted cash flow was. Trying to do a bond issue without discounted cash flow, and you'll be out of work pretty quickly. But one of the things that really helped me in my investment banking career was that I worked with large health systems, and even though large health systems ostensibly do the same thing, they are so different culturally. You can go into a place like Advocate, which is a regional system, has religious roots. Some of the Catholic systems, when I worked there, still had nuns and habits and big prayers at the beginning of meetings. And on the other end, you'd almost go to some organizations and they were cut and dried, for-profit, no-nonsense kind of thing. So all ostensibly doing the same thing. So in order to navigate effectively as an investment banker, I found, I've got to know how to do discounted cash flow and put bond documents together and understand the economics of mergers and acquisitions. But at the end of the day, it was really connecting effectively with people and operating in cultures. And I'm belaboring this point a little bit because this is a marketing group, and so much of what you do is trying to figure out not what's the picture in your own head, it's the picture in the audience that's with you. So really important to have that cultural sensitivity, particularly as we all try to navigate in what's increasingly becoming a post-industrial, very pluralistic, globalized world, much harder than it used to be. And from that, then I went to Harvard, to the Kennedy School, thinking I was going to be working in international development. Met my future wife, discovered I liked finance. The thought of living the rest of my life overseas suddenly wasn't quite as attractive. And after a little bit of term in government, I became an investment banker and learned all about economics and markets and how that works. So Steve Jobs gave a speech, in commencement speech at Stanford in 2011. If you haven't heard it, I'd recommend. I've seen some. It's just incredible. It's three stories, and they're all powerful. The first story was that the dots in life connect in retrospect. And the example he used was creating the fonts for the Apple computer. So when Steve Jobs dropped out of college, he dropped into classes periodically, things that interested him. One of them was a calligraphy class at Reed College. And that's where he learned all about the fonts and the font sizes and the different shadings and different ways to color. And fast forward 10 years, they're building the Apple operating system. He said, why don't we put all these great fonts into the Mac? And of course, Microsoft ripped off Mac. So the reason we have all these great fonts in the computers today is because Steve Jobs sort of early on said, I sort of have an interest in this, whether you call it karma or gut or instinct, came together and it connected in retrospect. So when I was trying to answer the question, okay, well, why should someone like me write this book about healthcare? It's 20% of the economy. There's all kinds of smart people. And I was thinking about the Steve Jobs speech, and I said, well, healthcare is pretty complicated. Maybe you need literary sensibility, cultural sensitivity, public policy acumen, and market knowledge to really understand everything that's happening in the industry. And to the extent I have a talent or an advantage, it's I can really look at this very complex industry through each of those lenses, so the dots really do connect in retrospect. And so that's enough of the bio, but I thought you'd enjoy that. So the book itself has four sections, and I call them the four A's: assess, align, adapt, advance. Assess is until you define a problem, you really can't talk about solving it. Align is sustaining innovation. So I don't know if people in here follow Clay Christensen of Harvard, the disruption guru, but he generally talks about two kinds of innovation: sustaining innovation, how do you get better at what you're supposed to do. So in healthcare, that means less variation in performance, more consistent outcomes, better customer experience. How do you get better at what you're supposed to do? Then disruption, there's a whole theory of disruption, I won't get into it, but that's where industries turn overnight because new models emerge and suddenly the old capabilities aren't up to the competitive market challenge. So, the classic example is Kodak. Kodak was an icon, the third leading brand in the world. Even patented many of the digital components that ultimately come to define these things, right? Somebody told me he started this meeting with Snapchat pictures. Well, in the old days, you may have had a Polaroid, and everybody would have taken a Polaroid, and there would have been no way to copy it and get it around. But so Kodak was really, really good at film, but didn't quite get digital. And so that's an example of the kind of disruptive change. Of course, in healthcare, the real disruption is going to be when we change the way we pay for healthcare. Right now, it's an activity-based payment model. Get paid for doing things, not always doing the right things. And we're in the very early stages of shifting toward payment either for specific outcomes, bundles. You're going to get paid one amount of money to do a joint replacement, or a capitated payment where an insurance company and a health plan together, an integrated system like Advocate will receive a certain amount of money per member per month, and then we'll have to handle all of the healthcare requirements for that person. Well, under that system, capitated payment system, a hospital visit is an expense, it's not a revenue unit, and keeping people healthy and out of the hospital is going to be the really important task to do. So we as an industry need to manage this shift. So one thing you can say about Kodak, nobody ever said they were bad at film. Right? They didn't quite get digital, but nobody said they were bad at film. In healthcare, what we're really kind of saying to our industry is, you know, you're not all that great at what you're supposed to be doing, so you need to get a whole lot better. And by the way, while you're getting better at more consistent care, more compassionate care, fewer errors, better customer service, while you're doing all that, by the way, get ready for this new pricing model that's going to flip all the incentives on your head, so what you've been doing for the last 50 years won't make sense anymore. So it's a real challenge, and I wonder sometimes how many organizations are really up to the challenge. I happen to believe Advocate is one of them, and it's one of the reasons I wanted to come here and talk to you today. So the last part of the book, Advance, was the most fun to write, and yet at the same time is perhaps the most scary. We as human beings aren't built for modern life. You may have noticed this. When we were evolving on the Serengeti, what did we learn how to do? Walk long distances, live in small cooperative communities, eat mostly fruits and vegetables, and respond to danger opportunity quickly. What's modern life? Sedentary work, sedentary entertainment, abundant food, and by the way, don't think I haven't noticed all the candy on the table. abundant food, much of it terrible, and then a type of prolonged stress that eats away at the immune system. So we as a society really need to figure out how to make it easier for people every day to make smarter lifestyle choices. Otherwise, we can fix the healthcare system. That's what we're going to talk about the rest of the day. You know, right care, right time, right place, right price. But if we do nothing about these longer trend lifestyle issues, we're on as a society and perhaps as a world on the road to oblivion. So the last chapter, since I figured I was only going to write one book, I decided, well, let me get some thoughts together on how we start to think about this larger challenge as well. So that's the work. So let's get into it. So believe it or not, I had to give a speech in India about 3 weeks ago. I debated whether or not healthcare was a commodity or a basic human right. I was there for 2 days in Mumbai, India. And it took 2 days to one to fly there and come back. So I think I was in the air as long as I was actually in India. But one of the things they asked me to do in this debate was to make it a little bit more international, and I also did a talk on my book. So I put this together, and the debate topic, you know, is healthcare a commodity or basic human right? It's kind of a dumb question. You can say that healthcare is a basic human right, and I happen to believe it is, even though I was arguing against it. But then so what? You know, you still have to deliver the healthcare and pay for the healthcare. And societies all around the world have struggled or are struggling to figure out how to do this in the most effective way. And we essentially have five models that come out. So socialized medicine, which originated in Great Britain under Lord Beveridge, is basically the government owns the hospitals, caregivers work for the government, government covers all the costs, there's not even a bill. So it's socialized medicine. Single payer system, which really emerged in Canada in the early 70s, is private hospitals and doctors, but then the government providing the payment. Actually, Canada modeled their system after the US system, Medicare system, and it's actually called Medicare. That's the single payer system. The third system is originated in Germany in the 1880s when Bismarck was the chancellor, and it was essentially private hospitals, private doctors, private insurance companies, but then the government forcing a global budget on the system and forcing the parties to negotiate with one another. So it was private participation, but with very heavy government management of the process. And that still continues today. Now, interestingly, the U.S. has all three of these systems. We've got socialized medicine in the Veterans Administration. We have single payer, as I mentioned, in Medicare. And then our commercial insurance is a form of the German system without the overall control. So for the U.S., which is exceptional, I call it selected budget. So we got largely private hospitals and doctors, both government and private funded insurance. But in the coverage, instead of being universal, is targeted. And then India, where I happen to be speaking, also is perhaps the best example of what happens when you have just pure market-driven healthcare. It's what economists call a natural experiment. 70% of the healthcare in India, people pay for it out of pocket. So you have private hospitals and doctors. There really isn't any insurance to speak of, no pre-existing coverage, so you get just market-based care. And what's interesting about that is its segment. So at the top end, the health systems are as good or even better than anything that you'll see here in the United States or around the world. Just remarkably high levels of care. And then at the bottom end, it's pretty interesting. There have been a number of remarkably innovative companies that have taken almost a manufacturing approach to surgery. So I happened to tour one in Bangalore called Narayana Health 3 years ago. Their ORs open at 7 in the morning. They work 7 days a week. They go until 1, 2, or 3 until the number of surgeries for the day is done. They have entire teams of operating engineers that spend all of their time thinking about, okay, how do I extend the life of existing equipment? How do I find lower cost substitutes? How do I improve throughput? Really take a constant performance improvement manufacturing approach to surgery. And as a result, they're able to do bypass surgeries with outcomes as good or better than the Mayo Clinic for $2,500. The average price in the US is $80,000. And my guess is in this market, most bypass surgeries are over $100,000. Now, as it happens, Narayana Health and Ascension Healthcare formed a joint venture and are building or built and opened 2 years ago a high volume cardiac and orthopedic surgical hospital in the Cayman Islands. So an hour flight from Miami, this is now a reality. And they can't do bypass surgery there for $2,500, but they can do it for $25,000 and it comes with a leak on the beach. So one of the interesting things to think about it is when you look at this, these lighter blue areas are examples of centralized top-down systems. And you're going to see in a minute why I think at the end of the day they are less effective at allocating resources than bottom-up market-driven systems. But you could argue convincingly today, it's not hard, that both the United States and India underperform in terms of the amount of healthcare they provide and the cost they provide relative to their peer countries. But what's really interesting is the amount of innovation that's occurring in these two countries in healthcare delivery models is orders of magnitude greater than what you're seeing in the centralized system. So what you're all experiencing here is part of a bottom-up revolution that is completely rethinking how we deliver and receive healthcare in the country. One of the things that's driving this are just record amounts of private equity and venture capital funding pouring into not only healthcare services, but provider-based services. Megan mentioned that I'm author in residence at Matter. And if you haven't seen that, you ought to just go. It's in the 12th floor of the Merchandise Mart. It's only been open a couple of years. It's already the largest healthcare incubator in the country. It's got over 150 companies in there. And those people are getting up every day trying to figure out how do they make a difference in the system. It's also got 70 sponsors I think Advocate might even be one of the sponsors, but they're kind of the who's who in the metropolitan region. So American Medical Association, the Abbott and other pharma companies, health systems, associations, and so on. So that didn't exist 2 years ago, and now it's the largest incubator in the country, and sort of magnify that across the country. So we're at a really interesting time, and we're at the most interesting place to figure out how to get healthcare funded and delivered. Now, having said that, you know, the U.S. is just a strange place. So I had to give a talk in New Jersey in the early 1990s, and they wanted me to answer the question, why is American healthcare the way it is? It's not like Canada, it's not like Europe, not like Japan, not like any of the developed countries. Why is it the way it is? And at that point in time, I was looking for any opportunity to speak in front of any group. So even though I had no idea how to answer the question, I said, sure, I'll come talk. Peace Corps spirit. So it's like 2 months before, and so I got plenty of time. And then it's a month before, and I still don't know what I'm going to say. And it's 2 weeks before, and I'm starting to get nervous. And then it's a week before, and I said, well, I got to come up with something. And I found myself going back to some coursework I took in college, and one course in particular called Religion in America, which was the first time I ever heard the concept American exceptionalism. And from its very origins, America's believed it's been a special place. So Jonathan Edwards, who was the leader of the Puritans, gave a sermon in 1636, so 6 years after they'd arrived in the United States. Reagan quoted it frequently, was the City on a Hill speech. We are a city on the hill with the eyes of the world upon us. Well, I gotta tell you, nothing could have been further from the truth. I mean, they were stuck in New England, you know, thousands of miles from anybody that counted. Their biggest interaction was with the Native American people that were in the immediate area. I mean, nobody had their eyes on what the Puritans were doing, and yet they believed they were special and destined for greatness. And that spirit sort of imbued the country from its very origins. It's how it spread west and won two world wars and so on. When French philosopher de Tocqueville came here in the 1800s, he marveled at how strong community organizations were in the United States. Literally, the country was growing faster than governments could keep up. And when communities were lacking, they just organized themselves. You still see that profound experience in America everywhere today. It's a big part of the origin of companies like Advocate. I happen to see, anybody here see the movie Brooklyn? One hand, okay. Mm-hmm. Two hands, okay. It was one of the films nominated for Best Picture, not this year, but last year. It's the story of a woman who emigrates to the United States, Brooklyn, in the 1950s. And this was before air travel was frequent, so she had to come over on a boat. And she's going through Ellis Island the first time, and she's scared to death. I mean, she had been sick on a boat trip over. And there's a woman she'd met on the boat who'd clearly done this several times. She's dressed to the nines, got her makeup, her hair, everything looks great. And she says to her, as she's about to go up, she said, you know, stand up straight, speak in a clear voice, think like an American, think like American. And it's actually a nice little twist in the movie because at the end she gets to be this sophisticated person giving advice to a terrified young woman, another young woman coming to Brooklyn. And so I said, well, what does it mean to be think like American? We are by nature a restless, problem-solving, forward-moving people. And, you know, healthcare is a tough problem to solve if that's how you think. And so we are always pushing the frontiers of science, but we sometimes have forgotten that a lot of healthcare occurs in the very basic ways, which is, you know, living in a good community, taking care of yourself, taking care of others. So we need to recapture some of that. So anyway, to get back to my speech, I'm sitting there thinking about, okay, what are some quintessential American values? you know, what does it mean to think like an American? And I rate them around the country here. So there are things like good in a crisis, but an aversion to central planning. I mean, we're having that debate right now about the debate about healthcare policy at the government level. It's really, what should the government's role in healthcare be? And there are very strong opinions on that both ways. But generally speaking, the country is not predisposed to centralized government-led solution. But does believe in competitive markets. There's a strong sense of individualism. There's a strong sense of community orientation. There's a belief in miracles. By the way, that's just a coincidence that's coming out of Southern California. So when you put it together, it in some ways distills down to what we have today, which is the best healthcare money can buy, incredible innovation, but at the same time, enormous coverage gaps, and a tendency to blame the victim. So if you don't have health insurance, you know, that's your fault. It's not the system's fault. So American exceptionalism is something that cuts both ways, good and bad, and it's why we confound the world in good ways and bad ways, and why we confound ourselves frequently. And healthcare is, with 20% of the economy, is really where the rubber meets the road on this tension that's been with us from the very beginning. So the result of that is when we ultimately solve healthcare, it's not going to look like Canada. It's not going to look like Germany. It's not going to look like Japan. It's going to be uniquely American, for better or worse. I've actually come to believe it's the public policy challenge of our lifetime, because we cannot continue to spend upwards of 20% of our economy and not address the lifestyle challenges that we as a country. So while we can talk in abstract ways around these numbers, we really do, as an industry, need to figure it out. How do we make healthcare better for everyone? So the answer to my question 20 years ago, the punchline was, if you want to know why healthcare looks the way it does, or is the way it is in America, just look in the mirror. Reflects who we are, our history, our experience, our culture. So we got ourselves into this mess. We have to get ourselves out. So Walter Cronkite in the 70s made this statement that American healthcare system is neither healthy, caring, nor a system. Has artificial economics. I'm going to get into that in some detail. I believe there's a massive acute care asset bubble. Too many hospitals, too many ambulatory care centers. I mentioned the institution in India to you a moment ago that runs its ORs almost 24/7. The average operating room in the U.S. runs, and I'm sure some of you know this, runs one shift a day, four and a half days a week. There is not another industry that takes capital-intensive assets and runs them in such a limited fashion. So how we ultimately